The properties of linearity and shifting are pretty much the most fundamental Laplace transform functions that are property thingies that you're going to end up needing, at least initially in DPQ class. So the linearity idea is, say I'm trying to take the Laplace transform of some function a, or some constant a times some function, and then some other, you know, constant times some other function. And we're also going to say that I happen to know the Laplace transform of f of t is equal to some, you know, thingy, and the Laplace transform of g is also equal to some thingy like that. Okay, so the idea is that if I was going to do this in real life, that I would be doing an integral. So I go integral this e to the minus st times this function, because that's how I do Laplace transforms. This is kind of a proof that's kind of easy to see, and it kind of makes me happy, so yay. So I'm going to go a e to the minus st f of t b e to the minus st gt. Now, because this is integration, specifically because this is integration, integration is linear, which is why, you know, Laplace transforms are linear, but I'm giving it away before we even get there, which means that I can break this up into two separate integrals. This is really not that exciting. I'm sorry, I'm doing the best I can. Maybe if I act perkier, it'll seem like it's funner. So here we go. Because it's a constant, I can pull the constants out of the integrals. And lo and behold, I have some math that says that since I know this right here is actually the definition of a Laplace transform, right there, that's the definition of the Laplace transform for f of t, which I happen to know is f of s because I arbitrarily said so, g of s. So basically what this means, if you can't tell, what this means right here is that we've shown that the Laplace transform of two individual functions, basically the Laplace transform of a f of t plus b g of t is equal to a times the Laplace transform of the first one. Basically, I can pull the constants out. The idea is, essentially, I can pull the constants out and I can separate things at plus signs. I'll make that a little bit smaller. So this is actually really kind of neat and really important, and allows us to solve Laplace transforms really straightforwardly. So if I had something where I was trying to find the Laplace transform of 6 plus 5t, something like that, then I could simply find the Laplace transform, so I could say the Laplace transform of 6, try one more time, 6 times the Laplace transform of 1, and then 5 times the Laplace transform of t. I know the Laplace transform of 1 is 1 over s, and the Laplace transform of t is 1 over s squared. So that allows me to solve a Laplace transform rather straightforward, rather quickly, without too much of a fuss, specifically because it's linear. Now notice that it's not that the Laplace transform of, it does not say that f times g is f times g, because that would be completely ridiculous, because that would be like saying that the integral of f times g was equal to the integral of f times the integral of g, and if it was, then like cal 2 would be super duper easy, and you know that's not true. So the idea is that if you can't do it with integrals, you can't do it with Laplace, so don't let it freak you out. It's really not a big deal, but if you would not naturally want to do it with, assuming your instincts are good with calculus, if you wouldn't want to do it in calculus or with an integral, then you definitely don't want to do it with a Laplace transform. So that's called linearity. The other one is called shifting. So the idea behind this one is, again, let's assume that we have some Laplace transform of some function f of t, and then that's equal to some function of s, okay? So we're going to say, well, what happens if we want to take the Laplace transform of e to the a t times some function t? This happens actually more than you would think. So this is a shifting theorem, okay? So the shifting theorem, I'm just going to apply it straight to the definition. or not apply it, but I'm going to investigate it by applying the definition. So I have e to the minus st, which is the definition of the Laplace, e to the at, ft, dt. Okay, so that gives me the integral of 0 to infinity, e to the, let's see, how do I do this, negative a, sorry, s minus a. T, f of t, dt. All right, now without loss of generality, and I like how people say that, like it's somehow more obvious to say without loss of generality by saying log, but we're going to say that without any trouble at all, I'm going to let some random variable called flower equal s minus a. Now what's amazing about this is once I let flower equal s minus a, I have what is essentially a Laplace transform again, except instead of having an S, I have a flower. And if we know anything about algebra, we know that that should not present a problem. So essentially what that means is I'm going to get the Laplace transform of T, or of F, in terms of flower. And I said that flower was S minus A, therefore, whenever I take the Laplace transform of something times e to the at, then that essentially shifts the Laplace transform by that value, by the a value. And where this can come into play is to say I had a problem like I was trying to find the Laplace transform of, let's do e to the 5t times sine of 2t. Something like that. Okay? So I know that the Laplace transform, I say this like it's so obvious now, the Laplace transform of sine of 2t would be equal to 2 over s squared plus 2 squared, or s squared plus 4. So essentially what I'm going to do is everywhere I see an s, I'm going to substitute in with s minus a. And in this case, a is 5. A is 5, because it's right there. So A is 5. So essentially, I'm going to write the exact same thing I had before, except everywhere I have an S, I'm going to put S minus 5. Like this. And that's all there is to it. So you can do tons of problems like this, just taking Laplace transforms. Really, the more, I guess, challenging something part is to find Laplace or inverse Laplace transforms. But you've got to have a basic working knowledge of the shifting and of the linearity in order to make the inverse Laplace transforms work.